Now, God, we thank you for another chance and another opportunity to stand before these, your people. Father, as I so often declare, I ask, God, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, God, I ask that they will be acceptable in thy sight. For God, I don't want to do anything for vainglory or selfish ambitions, but that all the glory and all the honor may be thine. So use me as a vessel, O God, for you this day. Put flesh under subjection. Put Eugene under subjection. Cast him out of the way right now so that your spirit, Holy Ghost, can have his way. Have your way even now, God. Season these words, oh God, that they may be words of life to encourage these your people. Bless even now, God. Continue to reign upon us even now, God. And continue to honor, God, our commitment to you in the mighty name of Jesus. For we walk by faith and not by sight. And God, if I go by what I see, God, it could be discouraging. Oh, God, it can be disconcerting, God. But God, right now, God, I bind everything that's unlike you, God. And I look towards you. I look towards the hills from whence cometh my help. Because I know that my help comes from you, the God who made heaven and the God who made earth. And so I said, lift up your hands, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your hands, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. So have your way in us, God, this evening, this morning. And let your spirit have his way. Saturate us even now. And we'll bless your name. In Jesus' precious name we pray this morning. Amen and amen. Turn quickly with me to 1 Timothy chapter 4. I will be reading verses 12 through 16. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. And I'll say it one more again to allow everyone to get their scriptures together. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12 through 16. And the word of God says this: let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of hands of the presbytery. Verse 15, meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord on this morning. In the NIV translation, verses 15 and 16 reads as such: be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them, so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely, persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. So for a few moments from those two last scriptures in 1 Timothy chapter 4, I would like to use for a topic this morning, and for those that are in the house, we do have inserts in your programs that you can write down the subject and you can write down the scriptures. For a few moments, I would like to speak from the topic, executive orders. Repeat after me, executive orders. In our federal government, an executive order is a rule or order issued by the President of the United States. And he issues this order to an executive branch of government and having the force of law, meaning that once it is written into, he completes and puts his signature on that document, that executive order, it becomes the law of the land. And oftentimes, presidents write executive orders when there is something missing or something has adequately been addressed by the government or by Congress. And President Obama has used executive orders for several things. I think he's written over 235 executive orders while he's been in office. He's written an executive order for gun violence reduction. He's written another for cybersecurity. He's written another for fair pay and safe workplaces. And he's written so many others. I believe he's written one so that those who, I don't want to call it tattletale, but those who a whistleblower executive order to protect those that whistleblow against government entities that are doing things that are corrupt and outside of the law. And they're put in place, these executive orders are put in place when there is no policy or law to govern this certain area or instance. Executive orders have been given throughout the Bible on many occasions. We don't just use them in the land, but executive orders, yes, that has popped back on. Executive orders have been used throughout the Bible on many occasions. And just in case you didn't know, the Ten Commandments was an executive order. There was no law in the land at that time. There was only the covenant between Abraham and God, and the people were doing things that was right in their own eyes. They were doing anything, and God needed to get them reined in, and he needed to get them into a point of standard so that they would follow after holiness and follow after his will. And so the Ten Commandments was an executive order. When God told Joshua to fear not in Joshua 1, it was an executive order. In Joshua 1, he says, "Lo, as I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. And so since I'm going to be with you, you have no reason to fear. So fear not and be strong and courageous." It was an executive order to encourage Joshua and to let him know that God will be with him and that God planned to not to forsake him and that he would be the leader to lead the children of Israel into their promised land. They had been wandering in the wilderness for 40 years and Moses, their leader, had died. And so it was time for a new leader and he needed to have the instructions to be able to lead the people successfully over into the promised land of Jerusalem. When the psalmist urged the readers to praise ye the Lord in Psalm 146, 147, 148, 149, and 150, it was an executive order. He told us in 150, "Let everything that has breath." And so if you are breathing in the house of the Lord of today, you have been given an executive order to praise ye the Lord, to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. That was an order that he gave us to bless the Lord at all times and let his praises continuously be in our mouths. In Malachi 3 and 8, Malachi wrote to the people and gave them instruction from God that says this: "Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in my house and prove me now." That was an executive order because they were not bringing the tithes into the storehouse. And so the churches were in lack and the house of the God was in lack. It was not able to do everything that it needed to do because the people were not bringing in their offering, their sacrifices, their 10% of their income into the house. And so he had to encourage them. He had to write an executive order to let them know to bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in my house. That means we have supplies. That means we have electricity. That means we have the things that we need to be able to be about God's business and to be the ministry that God needs us to be. And God doesn't tell us or give us that executive order just for selfishness. But when we bring the tithes into the storehouse, he says that if you don't do that, you'll be cursed with a curse. And so when you bring the tithes into the storehouse, you are blessed when you offer unto God that 10%. He gives you the right to keep the 90%, but when you don't bring in the 10, God takes some of that 90%, and that 90% ends up being less than the 10% that you should have given God right off the top. So that was an executive order as well. When Jesus told the disciples to go to Jerusalem and wait in Acts chapter 1, it was an executive order. He was telling them to go wait because you're going to receive power. They were lost. They were scattered. Beware of the government. They were in fear, of the government. They needed an order, some instruction to be able to get them into the right path, into the right position to get the power that they needed to be the examples, to be the disciples, to spread the good news of Jesus Christ to those that are dying into Jerusalem and Judea and into the uttermost parts of the world. If they
did not meet the Holy Spirit, or if they did not follow Jesus' executive order to go to Jerusalem, they would not have been equipped to do what Christ needed them to do. And that's to spread the good news of Jesus to the ends of the world. And he won't return until this day. He won't even return in this day until we do what God has called for us to do. And that is to share the good news of Jesus with everyone. So the executive orders that God has given in the Bible, they still apply to us today, even yet in this day and time. And so just as the government heeds the mandates of presidential orders or executive orders, we too as believers should heed the mandates outlined in the Bible, because they help us to live right. They help us to remain away from sin or to turn away from sin. They guide us and direct us towards God, and they lead us to a life that's pleasing unto God. So in Paul's first epistle that he wrote to Timothy, there is a litany, or a whole bunch, if you don't understand the word litany, of executive orders, and to not only encourage Timothy to continue to fight the good fight of faith, but these orders, these directions, these words of encouragement and guidance were also there to encourage Timothy to be the leader that God had destined for him to be. It's important for us to have fathers in the ministry to help lead us along the way. It should be our mission, it should be our believers or our mission, not just to be a believer, but also to find ourselves pressing to a higher calling in God every single day. For us to be able to press higher to a high calling and to avoid some of the obstacles that come our way, we need to have a listening ear and a willingness to listen to the fathers that are there to help guide us. We cannot do this life or walk this life or walk along this perilous pathway on our own. And if you know it all, then you are destined to fail. You are destined to fall short of God's glory. If you know everything and can't hear a sound advice, then you are destined to fail and to come up short. But God places people, God places individuals in our lives to help us along the journey, to help us along this Christian walk, so that we can be effective in ministry and effective in our Christian journey. In Proverbs chapter 12, verse 15, the Bible tells us this: the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise. In Proverbs 11 and 14, the Bible tells us this: where no counsel is, the people fail. That means the people die or come up short. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety, there is peace, there is deliverance in the counsel, in the multitude of counselors. Then in Proverbs 15 and 22, the Bible says this: without counsel, purposes are disappointed. But in the multitude of counselors, they are established. Meaning that our plans, when we get our plans and bounce our plans off a multitude of people that are wise and a good counselors, then our plans come to fruition. But when we do that on our own and we walk in our own might and we walk in our own strength, then we fail. We are doomed to disappointment and doomed to failure. Then in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 9, the Bible tells us this: what has been will be again, and what has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. And so when we look for wise counsel, and when we listen to wise counsel, then we don't have to worry about disappointment. And so we don't have to create the wheel again. We don't have to start from scratch. But the Bible tells us that there is nothing new under the sun. So everything that you are going through, everything that you have a desire to do, everything that you have a vision to go for it and to reach forward to, it has been done by someone already. And we don't have to go into this journey with blindfolds on, but we can lean onto a mentor, a spiritual mentor that have already been through the trials, that have already been through the tribulations, to help guide us along the way, to give us solutions, to give us suggestions from their experience, to help us to be able to walk in victory and walk in the Spirit of the Lord and in the beauty of holiness. And so Paul was this mentor towards Timothy. He was this guide towards Timothy, and he gave them orders or directions to be able to help him effectively lead the church or the saints at the church of Ephesus. Timothy joined Paul for most of his missionary journey. Timothy was more likely a teenager when he first met Paul. As Paul was going through Lystra, he met with Timothy's grandmother and Timothy's grandmother, and they were considered to be faithful women or faithful Jewish women who taught the Old Testament. Remember that they didn't have the New Testament. So when they were teaching of the word, they were teaching of the book from Elias. And and Isaiah and from the books of the law. They were teaching the word that they had been given at that time. And so these women were known as faithful women. And in Acts chapter 16, verse 2, it says this about Timothy. It says that Timothy was well reported of by the brethren. And so Timothy had been taught from a young child by his mother and by his grandmother the books of the law and the books of the prophet. And so when people thought of Timothy, when Timothy's name came about in conversation, the word was that Timothy was well reported of by the brethren. Timothy had a good name. Timothy had a good reputation. Timothy was something that was good in the eyesight of people. And in Proverbs 22 and 1, the Bible tells this about a good name. A good name is rather to be chosen than great riches, and loving favor rather than silver and gold. And so my question, as I take a quick break on this executive orders message, what is your name in the eyes of people? Can people say that, claim that you have a good name? Are you well reported of in your home or on your job or on in your business adventures and in school? Are you well known? Is your name something good, or do people talk bad about your name? Because your actions speak of things that are ill. They don't follow after the teachings that you have been given. What is your name in the eyesight of the world? We must be a light into this dark and dying world. We must be people that are set upon a hill that cannot be hid, meaning if we call ourselves to be believers and we call ourselves to be Christians, our name should be written well. Our name should be spoken of well. And if people speak ill about us, it's a lie and not the truth. So we have to be careful of what our name is in the eyes of the people, because we want to be lights to lead them to the promise of Jesus Christ. And if our name is mud, people don't want to be around dirt. I know I don't want to be around dirt. I don't want to be around filthiness, but I want my name to precede me. I want my reputation to precede me. I want my actions and my walk and my life to precede me. And Timothy's life walked before him. His actions preceded him in every conversation in the land. And so we need to chase after a good name rather than riches in this world. Too often we run after the riches of this world and fail to live up to the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And so no matter what anybody else do, no matter what everybody else choose to do, holiness is still right. Holiness is still right. And so we must be holy. And Paul told Timothy this in 1 Timothy chapter 1. He told him, God expects us to be holy because he is holy. And God doesn't expect anything less out of his people than he expects of himself. He expects himself, or he walks right. He talks right. He lives right. He loves right. And so he expects everyone that's attached to him to live the same type of life and be the same type of example. That's what it means to be when we say we must be holy in all manner of conversation. That means what we say should be holy. Where we go should be holy. What we do should be holy. We should make sure that we walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we have been called, and walk worthy of being called children of the Most High God. And so Timothy had an excellent reputation. And it was because of his reputation that Paul invited him along to continue on the second missionary journey, where Paul and Timothy and Silas, and they visited Derbe and Lystra, Iconium, Antioch, Philippi, Thessalonica, Berea, Athens, and Ephesus. You may be familiar with some of those cities, because some of those cities are listed as books in the New Testament. In the book of Ephesus, was a well-taught church, or the church, excuse me, at Ephesus, was a well-taught church. They were a well-taught church because Timothy and Paul, they spent 3 years abiding with them and teaching them the amazing power of God. It was at the church of Ephesus that was identified in Revelation chapter 2. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2 says this in verse 1, unto the angel of the church at Ephesus, write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candles. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. He bragged upon them. He lorded over them because they were a church of dignity. They were a church of character. They were a church of love. But he goes on to say, but thou hast lost their first love. We have to be careful what our reputation was, what our reputations are. They were known as a church that did the work of God, but they fell short of God's glory. And I don't want to get to that. I'll get to that on another occasion. And so Paul, after he was released from prison, Ephesus was a church that was highly regarded. But after Paul was released from prison the first time, he came back to Ephesus and found the church in turmoil. He found the church in turmoil. And part of this turmoil could have been that they lost their first love, that they stopped focusing on what they were taught. And it's important for us to be hearers of the word and doers as well. It's not enough just to hear the word of God, but we must be committed to doing the word and putting the word into action in our lives. If we fail to put the words into action, then we are empty brasses. Brasses that are empty, that don't have anything to contain, that's good for nothing, that should be cast out, where we're not using the things that are being put into us and the righteousness and the word of God that breathes life into us. And so they fell into turmoil when Paul was away. And we must be careful that when the cat's away, we can't allow the mice to play. And oftentimes when the pastor or the leaders are not in place, then the people of God are not in place as well. And we must be steadfast. We must be committed to our calling and diligent to what God has commanded us to do. And so some men were allowed to come in to begin teaching half-truths and to teach wrong truths and to teach things that are outside of the doctrine that Paul had taught the church of Ephesus. And so they begin to teach that Jesus could not have been man and God at the same time. And we know according to the word that that's not true, because in John chapter 1 and 1 it says this, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him. It talks about Jesus. It talks about how great he was. I want to get all this and get it all down, because I was about to mistakenly say it wrong. It says this, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. All right? In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended him not. And so we know that they were telling fallacies, because Jesus was all man and he was all God at the same time. He was all man because he had to deal with the things in the flesh, but he was all God that he was able to rebuke the flesh and cast out devils and to do great things in the eyesight of God, because he was greater than us. No wonder he was able to bear the sins of the world on his shoulder. A man could not have done that. A man could not have done that, because we can't bear our own sins. We can't bear our own foolishness sometimes. We want to hide from ourselves sometimes. So he was all man and he was all God at the same time. And so we must be careful. The church of Ephesus had been a church that was rooted and grounded in love and rooted and grounded in the word of God. But someone came in, a wolf came in sheep's clothing and began to stir up in the midst of them. And we have to be watchful and prayerful that we just don't allow anybody to enter into the church and get into a place of authority and to be able to declare the word. We must try the word by the word. And that's why I encourage you all to take notes, that as I preach, that I'm not just giving you my opinion, but I'm constantly trying to stand before you to give you nothing but the word of God. And so we must know the word of God. People's opinions don't matter. People's thoughts don't matter, but we must give you what thus said the Lord, because it's the word of God that's going to keep us today. It's the word of God that sustains us. It's the word that of God that helps us to live, and it's the word of God that we're able to stand upon his promises and to be able to live the life that he's called for us to live. And so because of Timothy's faithfulness during Paul's imprisonment and his commitment to learning how to reach about or to teach about Jesus and serve God's people, Paul decided to leave this young man, who probably was around the age of 30, in charge of this great ministry, this great church at Ephesus. And he was put in place to teach the truth. We must put people in place that are only going to teach the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And Jesus, and John 8:32, Jesus said this to the people: "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." And so if something comes to you that don't set you free from the bonds of sin, then it's not the truth. We must be willing to hear the truth. There are no middle points and no middle grounds or no half-truths in the Lord. We need to know the truth, because the truth brings about life. When we deal in lies, lies deal in destruction. When we deal in lies, lies deal with death. When we deal in lies, it was lies that had a third of heaven be kicked out of heaven because they decided to listen to what the devil was telling them. He led them astray, and just as he led that third of heaven astray from coming, the third of angels in heaven to be led astray, he's trying to lead the people astray today. Don't let anyone steal your glory. Don't let anyone steal your relationship with God. Don't let anyone steal the word of God out of you, because it's the word of God that will keep you. And so Timothy was put in place by Paul, and he was subject by Paul. We must be careful that when we're put into positions of authority, that we don't get beside ourselves. Everyone is subject to somebody. I'm subject to Bishop Thomas, and Bishop Thomas is subject to Bishop Blake, and Bishop Blake is subject to the General Assembly. Everyone is subject to somebody. There is no point in the Church of God in Christ that somebody does not have somebody above them that they must answer to. And so Paul trusted Timothy. He had taught him, and he had put stuff into him that will allow him to be a successful leader, an successful believer, and a successful man of God. And so he wanted to encourage him as he put him into place. He encouraged him to not worry about his age. And in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, it talks about don't be fearful because of your age. Don't allow people to put you under subjection or to afflict you or to discourage you because of your age. And sometimes we have to listen to those that are younger than us, because they're listening to God. They're not having to deal with all the confusion of the world. They don't have to deal with all of the foolishness of the world. I told you a couple of weeks ago about Missionary Howard, talking about the young preacher back home that was preaching to the pastor. He was a young boy, but he was able to give them the adulterated gospel, because God is not a respecter of persons. He'll give the word to someone, and we must just have listening ears to hear and a heart to receive the word of God. So he told Timothy, don't be discouraged. Don't let anyone despise your youth, but be an example. We must walk by faith and not by sight, meaning that we must be an example of what we believe. If we believe in holiness, then we must be a holy people, because God has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Just be an example, Timothy, an example of holiness, an example in your word and in your conversation, an example of love, an example of being led by the Spirit, allowing the fruit of the Spirit to be manifest in your life. Allow yourself to be an example of me. Holiness knows no age, and it does not know any age. Holiness just knows holiness, and so we must be holy. And so to encourage Timothy to walk in holiness, Paul gave him these two executive orders. And I've already given you the description what executive orders were. And so he gave him these two executive orders as I come to my conclusion. This first executive order I want you to write down is he gave him the executive order to move forward. And the second executive order that he gave him was the executive order on catastrophe prevention. The executive order to move forward and the executive order on catastrophe prevention. The executive order to move forward. Paul encouraged Timothy to be diligent and go all in verse 15. He told him to be diligent and go all in. Diligent can be defined as constant in effort, attentive and persistent in your effort. That means you're not giving up hope, and that you're not giving in, but you're consistent and willing to go through anything to get to your destination and to fulfill the purpose of your life. Though trials may come our way, we have to be diligent in our effort to be acceptable unto God. Paul told Timothy to be diligent in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. When we are diligent, we understand that we don't have to be weary in well-doing, because in due season we shall reap if we faint not. When we are diligent, we understand that we must be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that our labor is not in vain in the Lord. When we are diligent, we are willing to go all